today for my workshop. Of course, I talk a lot about relative strength. So I think this is a topic that always generates a lot of interest. And so I try to look at it from different angles. So I thought today what I would do is just talk a little bit about a process that you can develop in terms of identifying relative strength. I view a default system as the StockCharts tactical rank. I mean, it's right here. It's already done for you, really. In chart school, I've got the article up here on the page where you can go through and find how StockCharts ranks these various companies. I think it's really important to understand how they're ranked. If you're looking for a stock that has shown tremendous relative strength over the last 5 years, the scooter might not be the best place to go, because if you just go through the formulas, you'll find that a lot of the calculation is based really on the last, you know, handful of months, and doesn't really go back years and years. So if you're looking for, you know, a company that's going to show high scooter score, I mean, obviously Apple's been a great performer for a long time, Amazon, great performer, but if they go through a period of 5 or 6 months where they're not performing well, their scooter rank is going to drop rather significantly. So you have to understand the parameters that are set by a particular relative strength system. So here, just understand that the scooters, when you start looking at these, I think they're an excellent way to at least initially begin a process. But just keep in mind that this is really based on a very short to intermediate term strategy. So that's the first thing I would say. Now, if we go into the dashboard and you start looking at some of these scooters, and I'll just go right down under member tools, and you can find that under reports and analysis tools, here are your scooter reports. And what this is going to do is it's going to break these stocks down between large cap, mid cap, and small cap. And if you want to look at ETFs, if the ETFs are your thing, then that's going to break it down. Or if you want to look at a couple of foreign areas, that's there as well. But if I was using it, because I do concentrate on individual stocks here in the U.S., I'd be looking at large cap, mid cap, and small cap stocks. Now, one of the problems with the way this is set up for me is I like to trade some of the best stocks within the best industry groups. Now, if you look at here, you're just going to find the rank in order, which is very helpful, but it is looking at it can be a stock in an area of the market that's not performing well. That can be at the top. So for instance, right here, large cap stocks, market access holdings, investment services. If we just pull this stock up and I pull up a relative chart, you're going to see this stock's been a great performer, and relative to its group, it's been a great performer, but the group itself has not been so great. That's important to know, in my view, because if a stock starts to lose its luster in, you know, to the upside, and it's part of a group that's been an underperforming area of the market, I think that's got a lot of risk in it. And so I'd probably want to keep a tighter stop. Whereas if I've got a stock maybe that's in a different area of the market, and let me take a look at something else, find a good one here. Food products. I mean, we're just talking food products isn't bad, even though it's been in a more defensive area. Let's pull up Hershey's. So Hershey's one of the top performers. Look at this chart. Looks pretty good too. But the difference here, in my opinion, is that now you're getting a stock in an area that just went to a 7 month relative high. So you might say, well, it's down from where it was last November, and I could certainly find another industry group that would be even better than this one. But I could at least point to the fact that this is a group that is now at a 7 month, or was just recently at a 7 month relative high to the S&P 500, and Hershey's is one of the best stocks. So I think there's a couple of components to this as you try to identify a process. It's more to me than just one stock that's been outperforming. I think part of it is also trying to find areas of the market that are outperforming, because if the area has been outperforming and then a stock is outperforming within the area like Hershey's, it's going to take two steps for this company to begin to lag. Number one, if the group continues to be strong, Hershey's might still pull back relative to the group, but still outperform the S&P 500 because its group is so strong. Or it could, you know, have some potential, or it could continue to be strong, but its group could lose a little bit of luster, and it could still be such an outperformer versus its group that it continues to perform the outperform the S&P 500. So there's really two prongs to this that I think is really important. And when you have the best stock within one of the best groups, the chances of that stock continuing to outperform the S&P 500, in my view, is better than if you have a stock, like I was just showing you, in investment services, like MarketAxe Holdings, because investment services hasn't been a great area of the market. So now I'm counting only on the relative strength of that individual stock. So again, that's just the way I look at it. You can look at it completely different. And everybody does look at it differently, but I think relative strength needs to be a part of your, you know, a part of your strategy. All right, let's move down to restaurants and bars. This has been a powerful area of the market. So we just talked about food products moving to a seven-month high. Let's pull up Chipotle. This is a stock I own. Chipotle making another breakout today. If I pull it up on a relative basis, you'll see that we continue to trend higher. The restaurant group continues to trend higher. Chipotle relative to its group is now breaking to a new 52-week high, probably an all-time high. Relative to the S&P, it's clearly breaking to a new all-time high. And the restaurants, see the difference here versus food products and certainly versus investment services? Now, all of a sudden, you've got this big move up in restaurants on a relative basis. And Chipotle is one of the best stocks. Today, the market, last time I looked, was down. And yet, here you have a stock that's continuing to go higher. Why? Well, it's one of the strongest stocks within one of the strongest industry groups in the market. I don't argue with that. I just hopefully can tag along for the ride. And so that's the way I use relative strength. So no matter what your system is, there's going to be some limitations. There's going to be some very good things about it, but there's also going to be some limitations. The stock chart technical rank, again, is an excellent way to quickly identify areas of the market and in particular, individual stocks that are performing and outperforming some of their peers based on market cap. So here you've got the large cap. You can scroll, you can go down and get the mid cap. Now, of course, before you come into large cap, mid cap, or small cap, it kind of makes sense to know which of those three areas are performing well. Because I, again, want to have my money where I think it's got the best chance to work its best for me. So if large cap stocks are outperforming mid cap and small cap, then large cap is kind of where I want to emphasize my holdings. And small cap, you can make all the arguments you want for it, but small caps have been underperforming for quite a while. And you can still find some great small cap stocks, don't get me wrong, but I think they'll do even better when the money begins to rotate more towards small caps. So here on the mid cap list, look at the top one, Roku. I was talking about recently computer hardware. I think computer hardware is just beginning to really strengthen relative to the S&P 500. I own Roku. Shopify, I did own. I actually got out of that recently and switched over to AYX. But these are both companies that have performed extremely well. So let's pull up Roku. What's encouraging about that stock? Well, again, let's flip to the relative chart. Roku continues to move higher today. It is up a little bit. It's off its earlier high, but still performing extremely well. Great volume trends. And you say, well, computer hardware, though, is not really broken out yet. You know, where are you seeing that strength? Look at the relative strength. It's been rising now for the last 3 months. So when you look at its absolute strength, it might not seem that much, but it's been better than the S&P 500. So if the S&P turns higher, you know that you've got more money, at least right now, rotating into computer hardware. So this is a space that I'm pretty interested in. Look at Roku relative to the computer hardware group and look at it relative to the S&P 500. In order for Roku to really begin to deteriorate, we're either going to need to see computer hardware underperforming in a big way or Roku underperforming computer hardware or both. And again, the chances of both happening, in my opinion, are not that great, especially if you have a portfolio of stocks like this. So Roku is part of a portfolio. It's part of the model portfolio that I have at Earnings Beats. And this is why I like these stocks that show great relative strength in groups that are beginning to show a lot of strength as well. Now, when you go into the small cap, again, you're going to find some stocks at the very top. Enphase Energy, this is one in my aggressive portfolio at Earnings Beats, and it's pretty much the same thing. We click on the chart, and we go to a relative chart. Here you go. I mean, it's going up, heavy volume. Look at the group. Renewable energy is the best group in the market in 2019. It's been the best industry group. And then look at Enphase relative to renewable energy and relative to the S&P. It's been a huge performer. So the more of these relative outperformers that you have in your portfolio, the better off you are. Does that mean that every one of these stocks is going to continue to go higher? Of course not. What you're banking on is that if you diversify into different industry groups that are all performing well, and you have leaders in those industry groups, you're hopeful that not all 10 of them are going to fall apart altogether. If we go into a bear market, yes, some of these are going to get hit hard because they're growth plays. They're going up because of the anticipation of higher earnings. So you need to be aware of what your risk tolerance level is when you're going through and setting up a relative strength strategy as well. If you go back here and you say, let's say, okay, I kind of think the market might go higher, but I'm really nervous about the trade war. I think the market, you know, is vulnerable. We're going into September. That's not a good month historically. Well, there are things you can do. First thing you can do is just type in Staples. Now, these are small cap stocks, but if I type in Staples, all of a sudden I've got the highest scooter ranked stocks among small cap consumer staple names. And if I want to make it large cap, just go back to the large cap. Hershey's right on top, one I just showed you. Estee Lauder, been a great performer of late. This is in a different area, personal products. Costco, breaking out, I showed you earlier, personal products. Let's see, Coca-Cola has been performing really well. Soft drinks, another staples area. So there are things you can do, all right? Not convinced there. How about real estate? So you got the real estate sector. These are ranked in sector order. Let's go, or in scooter order. Let's take a look now at SBAC. Let's pull this one up. You know, a lot of these staples names, by the way, and real estate names, they pay dividends too. So not only are you seeing, look at the relative strength here. You don't have to take all the aggressive names. You can go with more defensive names. But why would you want stocks that are underperforming the S&P 500? If you're a value investor, sure. You know, but you've got to wait to unlock that value. How long is it going to be? Is the value going to be unlocked in the next 30 days? Maybe. Is it going to be 6 months? Maybe. Might it be 3 years? Maybe. The idea with relative strength and following relative strength is that you're looking for that momentum now. You're not trying to catch a bottom. So SBAC, there's just a lot of different ways you can look at relative strength and identify a process that works for you. All right, one of the things that I like to do, first of all, is get a general sense of what I think about the overall market. And that is going to help me determine, do I want to be more defensive or do I want to be more aggressive? In my blog this morning, I wrote about why I'm bullish. And I said at the open today, I'm still a little nervous in the near term. Volatility is around 20. If we break those lows in August that have been holding, we could see a quick 100-150 point drop on the S&P 500. Would not surprise me. And it's because the market is irrational. When the volatility index is up in the 20s or jumps into the 30s, you can argue PEs, you can argue, well, you know, relative, you can argue anything you want. The stock market panics and the people who own stocks panic. It's a very emotional market and you can't really stop it. It's like jumping in front of a freight train. So you got to keep your stops in play from a short-term trading perspective. When I look at the market now, what I see is under the current outlook, I pulled up the S&P 500 and I looked not only at what it's been doing over the last 15 years on a weekly chart, but I also looked at the relative strength of the five aggressive groups. And if you go back to 2007, when we broke a trend line here and the PPO, weekly PPO, went negative on this break, I want you to take a look at what these relative, what the relative strength of the sectors were doing. Technology was getting crushed. Consumer discretionary on a relative basis. Look at this. It had been dropping for 3 or 4 years. There was no relative strength in consumer discretionary. Communication services didn't start that until 2007. Can't really look at that. Industrials not doing badly going into that. But look at financials. Really, industrials, the only aggressive area that looked even reasonably strong as we were making this breakdown in the overall market. And even leading up to these highs back in 2007, technology looked good, but consumer discretionary didn't. I mean, you would think with the S&P 500 at an all-time high or close to an all-time high back then, that consumer names would be doing really well. That was not the case. Completely different signal that the market was sending us. Let's fast forward to 2016 when, you know, I was a little nervous. I was nervous with the volatility index jumping. I know in among consumer stocks, staples were outperforming the its discretionary counterparts and so forth. But if you take a look back at when we were right on the verge of breaking down in January of 2016, technology had broken out to a new relative high. That certainly didn't look bad. Consumer discretionary just had a huge run up in the second half of 2015 and barely budged to the downside during this sell-off. All this selling, second half of 2015, consumer discretionary names were not being thrown out. Then you go into communication services. That looked bad? I don't think so. The only two areas that I think looked bad or even partially bad were industrials and financials. And industrials still were putting in higher highs, higher lows. And financials really didn't look overly, you know, horrible. So when you look at what's going on in the S&P, it didn't really make sense when you look at the story under the surface. And so the same thing, look at the December low in 2018. So right here, we come down, and essentially this line, by the way, the reason it's connecting these two lows is if you connect these two highs, I just dragged this line down. It's the same slope. So using the highs and connecting this big low back in 2011 didn't quite touch the 2016 low, but it touched that low in December 2018 perfectly. So we remain in the channel to the upside. Yes, technology got hit in the fourth quarter, but the overall uptrend, I mean, I think this looks completely different than maybe what we saw back here. I think after a huge run up to the upside, this to me is reeking of a secular bull market, not the secular bear market that we were in before. Money is pouring into technology. And when we went to the new high, first of all, we never got to a new high back in 2007. Here we did. So everybody thinking that that was bear market, that goes out the window when you set a new high. And on that new high, money continues to pour into technology and consumer discretionary. The only two groups that hit a relative high, only two sectors that hit relative highs in 2019, technology and consumer discretionary. All right, communication services, not great, but certainly not horrible. I mean, I think there's still an uptrend here in play. Maybe call it consolidation. Industrials and financials, again, the weakest, but could I argue that there's still an uptrend in play? Yes, and I would. Financials, is there an uptrend in play? I think so. I think these are two areas, financials and industrials, I think could lead, and we might see a pullback for a while in these other two areas. How could that happen? Well, if we start to show any kind of economic improvement and all this fear leaves the market, especially if a trade war is negotiated taken out, there's no longer fears over the trade war, I think you're going to see money rotate very quickly out of treasuries. That's going to send the yields higher. What's going to lead when the yields go higher? Financials and industrials. I'm not writing them off yet. I'm just not interested in jumping in until they begin to show strength and until the other markets, treasury market, begins to tell us it's okay. All right, so I believe we're in a secular bull market. So how does that impact me? Well, when I set up my relative strength strategy and process, I want to look for those aggressive groups. I'm not a believer of a bear market. If I think the market's going higher, I want to use relative strength in strong areas, strong aggressive areas of the market to line my portfolio so that when the market bounces and moves to a new high, my portfolio jumps more than the S&P 500. So how do you do that? Well, I have a chart list that shows relative strength of sectors, which we've already talked about. And then I also have a chart list of relative strength of industry groups. And here they all are. I got them all listed. And I've got the technologies first. So I'm going to concentrate on those. Just talked about computer hardware. Let's take a look. On a relative strength basis, here's computer hardware breaking back out above its 20-week moving average. This is a relative chart. Computer hardware divided by the S&P 500. This isn't telling us that computer hardware is going higher. It's telling us that it's outperforming the S&P 500. The relative PPO, this is relative momentum, is positive. When the relative momentum is positive, I'm much more interested in a group. We've now seen that 20-week moving average crossing above the 50. Look at what happened when the 20 is above the 50. We had a period of a couple years where you wanted to be in computer hardware. We went through a period recently where we didn't necessarily want to be there. I think we're getting back into one where we do want to be in computer hardware. So when I look at computer hardware, I just mentioned Roku. So let's pull up Roku. Talked about this one earlier. But I mean, this is how I would go through my whole process. I'm a secular bull. I believe the market's going higher. So I want to stick with the aggressive areas of the market, aggressive sectors. Technology, consumer discretionary are two big ones. They just broke to new relative highs. And then I want to find the groups within those areas. And that's where a lot of my investment's going to be. And you might say, well, you're not diversified. Well, I get back to what I'm going to paraphrase, but Warren Buffett, when he was talking about diversification, he said, really, it's a form of ignorance because you're putting a lot of your money into an area of the market that's not working. I want money diversified in a way, different industry groups, different stocks, but I want them all to be working for me. And so that's just part of my strategy. Now, Roku, yes, today right now it's down $1.39, and it's not like it goes up every day. But I think when you're looking at the relative strength, I don't think there's much argument. This has been a great performing stock. If you're trying to beat the S&P 500, Roku's a great way to do it. Roku has been in a portfolio of mine since back on May 19th right here. And I think you can see relative to the S&P, it's been a great performer. I mentioned Chipotle earlier. Pull this one up. Again, this is just another individual stock that kind of meets that whole criteria. Restaurants, which part of the market is that in? Consumer discretionary. Restaurants relative to the S&P 500, exploding to the upside. Chipotle, relative to restaurants, great performer. Relative to the S&P, great performer. Another one, how about Starbucks? In the same space, relative strength across the board, strong. Want a third one? Shake Shack. Shake Shack, big earnings report, continuing to move higher, relative strength off the charts. Those are just three quick names out of the restaurant area. And many of these, by the way, you would see on the scooter report that I showed at the beginning. But that was just a little sense of what I do to try to establish and identify my own relative strength process. Everybody's different. You got to find what works for you. And again, maybe some of you are value investors and relative strength means nothing. You might be looking for relative weakness because you're trying to find stocks that have a tremendous amount of value and you're willing to hold them. Maybe they pay nice dividends and you don't care if for the next year or two they're down. You think long-term they're great investments. That's a different trading style, certainly a lot different than mine, but it doesn't mean it's wrong. It's all in what works or fits in your own trading strategy. So that is it. I'll bring a summary up, just a few things that I talked about here. The scooters, again, that is a great default strategy and process right here at Stock Charts. What I would simply say is that there are a couple of limitations. Number one, the scooter, go back and look at the formula. It only goes back probably 5 or 6 months in terms of comparing relative strength. So you can look at gold, which has been, I showed you Newmont Gold Corp earlier. That was the scooter mover of the day. Remember, it's over 90. Well, that's because it's looking at the last 5 or 6 months. Gold's been great. If you were to look at a longer term chart, I think you'd probably agree gold has not been a very good area of the market on a relative basis. So know what it is that you're looking at. That would be the first step, Scooters. Sector relative strength to me is incredibly important. I have no interest in looking at energy and materials with one exception. In energy, we know renewable energy has been the best performing industry group. So I'm not going to ignore that just because it's part of a sector that's not performing well. So, but there's no area in materials right now that I'm overly excited about. Short term, yes. Gold mining, the miners in general, they're all doing well. But from the way I look at the market, a little bit bigger picture, that's not a group yet that I think has been strong enough for any period of time. So that's not the way I look at it. So you drill down from sector to industry group, and then industry group finding stocks to meet your individual goals. That is it.